On the first, we thank you for your kindness. We thank you for your love. We've been in heavenly places, felt blessings from above. We're bearing all the good things the family can afford. Let's just turn our praise toward heaven and praise the Lord. Let's just praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Let's just lift our hands to heaven and praise the Lord. Let's just praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Let's just lift our hands toward heaven and praise the Lord. Verse 2. Just the precious name of Jesus is worthy of our praise. Let us bow our knee before him, our hands to heaven raise. When he comes in clouds of glory, with him to ever reign, let's just lift our happy voices and praise his dear name. Let's just praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Let's just lift our hands to heaven and praise the Lord. Let's just praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Let's just lift our hands toward heaven and praise the Lord. All right, page 111, page 111. Praise him, praise him. On the first, praise him, Jesus our blessed Redeemer. Sing, O earth, his wonderful love proclaim. Hail him, highest archangels in glory. Strength and honor give to his holy name. Like a shepherd, Jesus will guard his children. In his arms he carries them all below. Praise him, tell of his excellent greatness. Praise him, enter in joyful song. Verse 2, praise him, Jesus our blessed Redeemer. Jesus, who bore our sorrows, love us.
section this morning, congregation, will be 135. Jesus is all the world to me, page 135. First, Jesus is all the world to me, my life, my joy, my all. He is my strength from day to day. Without him I would fall. When I am sad, to him I go. No other one can cheer me so. When I am sad, he makes me glad. He's my friend. Verse 3. Jesus is all the world to me, and true to him I'll be. Oh, how could I this friend deny, when he's so true to me? Following him I know I'm right. Jesus is all the world to me. I want no better friend. I trust him now. I'll trust him when life's fleeting days shall end. Beautiful life with such a friend. Going to sing, I'm a friend of God, and what we a friend we have in Jesus. Jesus is our friend.
What a friend we have in Jesus. precious Savior, still our refuge. Take it to the Lord in prayer. To thy friends these pies forsake thee. Take it to the Lord in prayer. In his arms we'll take and shield thee. All because he calls me
The Lord put a message on my heart late last evening, probably just about dark, on saved to the uttermost. I've preached on it a few times already here, and I've preached on it in other places. It's a message about the fact that Jesus, because he is our high priest and he ever liveth to make intercession, he can save us to the uttermost. The salvation that he provides is real, true, it's eternal, and we, because of that, are kept by the power of God unto the day of salvation. Well, what a blessing it is to know that we have a salvation that's to the uttermost. I know there are folk that believe their salvation is what we call a hit and miss. Works one day and doesn't the next. But it works every day if you truly are born again. And that makes the difference. Having religion is not salvation. Being religious is not salvation. There's just so much that people are trusting to get themselves to heaven that won't get them to heaven. When we get ready to leave this life, and we're going to leave this life in one of two ways. Either the death angel will knock on your door. It may be quick, it may be immediate. You may not know that he's coming around the corner. Or it may be that you've lingered and suffered and you're ready to go because of all of your suffering. But one day the old death angel is going to knock at every door. The Bible says it's appointed unto men once to die. Every one of us is going to do that unless the second scenario takes place. And that's when Jesus returns for his church. We call it the rapture. And I know that word is not in our Bible. The word that we get that from is actually in a Latin translation. I won't try to give you the Latin word or any of the rest of it because I don't remember all that stuff. But it is an event, a snatching away, a catching up of the children of God. It's what Jesus promised in Acts chapter 1, verse number 11, when the disciples, the apostles, were there, and he was ascending into heaven, and the angels that were there looked to the apostles and said, "Ye men of Galilee, why stand ye here gazing up into heaven? For this same Jesus, which is taken from you up into heaven, shall so come again in like manner." He's coming again. It was promised when he ascended. It was promised before he ascended in John chapter 14, where he says, "Let not your heart be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you." He said, "I go away to prepare a place for you. And if I go away and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you unto myself, that where I am, there you may be also." So one day, we're going to leave this life. If you have a salvation that is to the uttermost, that means it'll carry you through the storms of life. South Louisiana, Mississippi, Alabama, and it's going to go all the way up to Tennessee and probably up around New York somewhere and maybe come out into the ocean up there and cause havoc all over the place, but they're in a storm. But no matter whether it's that kind of a storm or a storm of life, if you're truly born again, then you have a salvation that's to the uttermost. Let's go ahead and read verse number 25, Hebrews chapter number 7, and it's because of verse 24 where it says, "But this man, because he continueth ever, hath an unchangeable priesthood, wherefore he is able also to save them to the uttermost that come unto God by him, seeing that he ever liveth to make intercession for them." Let's pray. Father, we thank you again for your word and how precious it is. Lord, I pray that this morning that the word of God would do the work of God. Lord, not only here in the auditorium, the sanctuary where we meet this morning, but Father, if others pick up on it over the internet and hear it, Lord, I do pray that some that are in distress today, and that they would hear the word of God and that they would come to Christ and be saved. For some that are saved, that it would give them the comfort that they need and desire at this moment. Again, we pray, Lord, that you would be with us through the service. In Jesus' name, amen. We find that he is able also to save us to the uttermost. In a day of confusion about spiritual matters, and people trust a little bit of everything, in the day of the internet access to a bunch of gobbledygook religion, I tell you, there's one particular program, this church, the man's dead, that started it, has his own religious station, and he puts on all just him and his followers, the preachers that follow him, and he puts all kind of stuff on there. He talks about the original sin of Adam. I won't tell you what he says it is. He's just nuts about it. He talks about a whole lot of other things that he's nuts about. And it's amazing to me that anybody could watch two programs and not see that it's a bunch of religious gobbledygook, whatever that is. And but people get caught up in it and they say, "Oh boy, this person is, boy, they've got a great way of saying things." If it's not the truth, it don't matter what way they've got of saying it, it's still wrong. You need the truth. And the Bible's clear. The one thing that we know that Jesus said, one of the things that we know that he said, is that except a man be born again, he cannot see the kingdom of heaven. That's what he told Nicodemus. That was the words of Jesus. You have to be saved. You have to have a saved to the uttermost. Not a partially saved. Not a almost saved. Not a all but just a little bit. You've got to have a saved to the uttermost. And the Bible gives us that process, tells us what we need to do to be saved to the uttermost. I want to give you five things very quickly, or six, that people say about salvation. The atheist says there is no God. Why worry about it? That's what the atheist says, there is no God. I'll throw the atheist and the agnostics together. The agnostic says, "I'm not sure whether there's a God or not." And if there is a God, he said, the agnostic says, "I'm not sure whether you can even know him." The atheist says, "Don't worry about it because there is no God." And in Psalm chapter 14 and verse number 1, God says, "The fool has said in his heart, there is no God." I'm telling you, I can't understand anybody with an analytical mind, anybody that looks things out and searches them out, to see how this earth works, to see how the human body works, to see how anything works, and you tell me that there was no creator, that somebody didn't create these things, you tell me that it happened by accident, that nothing plus nothing equals everything, it doesn't work that way. God, and I don't understand all about God, and if you do, you can tell me later, but the eternal one and the self-existing one is what the word actually means, the one who is self-existent, the Eternal One, he somehow stepped out of nowhere, stepped on nothing, and took nothing and created everything that is. He created this earth. He created this solar system, planetary system. He created this universe, the galaxies. And then we're just one a bunch of multitudes of them. How far they go, I don't know. But I know that he's the one that created them, because they can't happen by accident. You can take a pile, and I've used this illustration many times. You can take a pile of automobile parts, and you can put them, just pile them up. Whatever parts there are. Yesterday I saw one of the Thunderbirds that looked like one of the old 56 Thunderbirds or whatever it was. Had the little porthole. It was one of the newer look-alike ones. And I remembered back in the day, I told Jan, I said, honey, I painted one of those years ago. And I had to stop and said, no, I didn't paint it. Actually, I put a vinyl top on one. And it was one of the old fake vinyl tops. It's where you took two pieces of tape that had ridges on it, put one down each side, and then you sprayed it with what I'd call bed liner today, some real thick spray paint with a little texture in it, and it made it look at a distance like a vinyl top. But you can take all the parts for one of those things, and that car was taken apart, completely, when it got painted, but I'm not the one that painted it. Got it back together and everything, and my job was to put the old fake vinyl top on it, and boy, I said, you know, you take all of those parts, every one, screws, wires, connectors, motor parts, everything, put them in a pile. Go back 10,000 years from now, and they'll still be in a pile unless somebody stole them. They don't put themselves together. Nothing puts itself together. God created everything. The Bible tells us that Jesus was the Word in the beginning. The Word was the spoken Word that created the heavens and the earth, designed all that is. And because of that, He is our Savior. The Scripture tells us that before the foundation of the world, that God had already planned the program for salvation. And that Jesus, in the mind of God, God the Son, would have to die for your sins and for my sin, for the sin of the world. And the atheist can say there is no God. The agnostic can say you can't know who God is. But God says you're a fool if you believe there is no God. And God is trying to reveal Himself to as many as will listen and look to Him. But it's those who reject Him. And those who reject His Word, that they're the ones that are not going to receive salvation. The self-righteous, or the person who is the moralist, the one who says, I am moral enough. I've told you the story many times about a man in Alabama who told me he knew he was a sinner. He knew he was a sinner. And when I said, so you're going to die and go to a devil's hell, he said, I'm a sinner, but I ain't that kind of a sinner. I hadn't never killed nobody in my life. I ain't going to hell. He thought he was moral enough because he knew some things about Christians that were immoral. And he said, if they're going, then I'm going. It's not about what they're doing. It's have you been born again? They believe they can get there their own way. I'm not bad enough. The religionist says, just do what you're told. Follow your religion. God will honor your sincerity. You may be sincere, but if you're sincerely wrong, you're going to die and go to a devil's hell. I think about in the Philippines and other countries around Easter time, what we celebrate as Easter. During the day of the crucifixion, there are many people, sometimes hundreds, who have themselves professionally nailed to crosses. Others get on their hands and knees, and they're not wearing knee pads, and crawl to the church on broken glass, on rock, gravel, and they're bleeding by the time they get there, and they reach up and touch their idols or their statues and pray for help and pray for forgiveness. You can be as sincere as you want and be sincerely wrong. You don't have to be crucified. You don't have to offer yourself. You have to trust the one who did offer himself, the Lord Jesus. The legalist says, keep the law. If you offend the law, you're going to die and go to hell. Keep the law. The law never saved anyone. Even Abraham and all the Old Testament saints, keeping the law didn't save them. The Bible says Abraham was saved by faith. In the New Testament, the apostles said, and this was the Apostle Paul in Acts 16:31, said, believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, and thou shalt be saved. He was telling the Philippian jailer that. When the Philippian jailer thought that they had all escaped, Paul and Silas had been singing praises until midnight. The earthquake came. All the doors were opened. And he just knew all of the prisoners had escaped. And he was going to take a sword and kill himself. And then Paul says, do thyself no harm. He got a lantern, got a light, and went in. Saw them all there. And he said, sirs, what must I do to be saved? Can you imagine the conversation? He had been hearing them singing praises and testimony. In other words, he'd been hearing preaching and singing all night. They weren't in the, you know, most of us as Christians, it's a, oh me. If it wasn't for bad luck, I wouldn't have any luck at all. Everything's against me. I just don't know if I'm going to make it to the next day. And we wonder why our loved ones don't want to get saved. Paul and Silas had been beaten and put in jail and was going to go before the magistrate the next day, and maybe much worse happened. And they were praising God. They were singing, testifying to the goodness and the grace and the love and the mercy of God. And when the jail cells, the bars were opened, and they didn't run away to escape their punishment, the jailer knew they had something that he didn't. And the apostle says, believe on the Lord Jesus Christ and thou shalt be saved. Not only did he believe, but the Bible says his whole family believed that night. It's amazing to see what they say. Here's what Jesus said, and I've already mentioned it. In John 3:13, Jesus said, you must be born again. He's talking about the difference in the physical birth and the spiritual birth. He said, you must be born again. You see, just being born means you're alive. But being born again means you have new life, and it's in Christ. It's explained to us. God's plan of salvation is so simple that many bypass it. Over the years, I've had people tell me, it's not that simple. It's not that easy. Yeah, you do have to call on the Lord and you do have to get saved, but then you got to work to keep it and you got to do this and you got to do that. And I said, not according to the scripture. The plan of salvation that God put together, and we know that 1 Peter says, before the foundation of the world was laid, that this was all put together by God himself, that is that Jesus, the Son of God, would come to earth, live a sinless life, and then be crucified, buried, and rise again the third day to pay for our sins. To pay for it. The Bible says that he paid for the sin of the world. But you don't get your payment until you come to him and let him wash your sins away. The cost was Jesus dying for your sins. That was the cost. His blood being shed on Calvary. Oh, it's simple, and you say it's just too simple. In that day, up until that day, there was always a blood sacrifice involved, always was. And when it came to Jesus giving a blood sacrifice, it ended all blood sacrifices. Those could only cover your sins for another year. From your obedience, they would cover your sin. But Jesus, his blood would wash your sin away. In Revelation 1:5, the last part of verse 5 says, unto him that loved us and washed us from our sin in his own blood. It's only the blood of Christ, the sacrificial payment that God the Father could accept in order for you to be saved. It was simple. The completeness of God's plan. In Hebrews 9 and verse number 12, it says, but by his own blood he entered in once into the holy place, having obtained eternal redemption for us. Jesus only died once. In fact, if we read the book of Hebrews, the 6th chapter, and I'm not going to turn or try to read or even to quote it, but the Bible tells us that if we try to get saved again, we bring Christ to an open shame. Why? Because he only died once. You only get saved one time. And it's a complete salvation. It's complete, but it's narrow. And that's where the world says, oh, every road leads to Rome and every religion leads to heaven. It's not the case. Zero religions lead to heaven. There's one way of salvation, whatever your religion is. Religion is simply man's way of trying to worship God. If you're trying to use religion for anything else, it won't work. Now, most of you men, we use our tools differently than what their purpose was. You know, if we need a hammer and we see a pipe wrench, we just grab the pipe wrench and it becomes our hammer. We need a screwdriver and it's too many steps to find a screwdriver, but we got that pocket knife. We just take it and, like I've done 100 times, break the tip off and then go get the screwdriver. But we think we can just apply anything and everything. But when it comes to salvation, there's only one way. Acts 4 and verse 12 says, neither is there salvation in any other, for there's none other name under heaven given among men whereby we must be saved. It's a narrow way of salvation. In Matthew 7, the Bible tells us there's a broad way and there's a narrow way. And many will take the broad way, but few go into the narrow way. Most people do not get born again because they don't go the narrow way. John 14 and verse 6, Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man cometh unto the Father but by me. Jesus is the narrow way. He's the only way. You see, it's an awesome salvation, but it's more than just an awesome salvation. It's an uttermost salvation. Well, God's supreme power brings this salvation. It doesn't happen just because there's a plan. Step 1, step 2, and step 3. But here we find in Hebrews 7:25, wherefore he is able to save them to the uttermost, that come unto God by him. It's God's power that saves you. It's not you becoming a church member. I remember as a kid, and I didn't understand this. I wasn't quite old enough and didn't go to this church. But my neighbor went to a Methodist church. In that Methodist church, before you could become a member, you had to be 12 years of age. But you not only had to be 12 years of age, you had to go through their catechism for the Methodist church. And you had to agree with that catechism. You had to say, I agree. Then at 12 years of age, you could be baptized. Their baptism was either or. It was either immersion or sprinkling. And this kid that lived up the road, he said, we're supposed to bring people with us, visitors. So can you come? Can your brothers come? Can all your family come? And so we asked what it was all about, and he told me what it was all about. And so I asked my mom. Dad heard it, and he said, well, if that boy's got religion, I ain't seen it. He didn't have it either, by the way. But at 12 years of age, he was old enough to say so, and he became a member. That's not what saves you. Following a step doesn't save you. Repeating someone's prayer doesn't save you. There are times when I lead people in their prayer, and I help them. I don't have to do it often. Most of the time, they know how they need to pray and what they need to say. But every now and then, you'll find somebody that just, I can't get the words. And I say, well, this is what I said. You say something very similar to this, but you have to mean it in your heart. It's not the steps. It's trusting Jesus. It's the power of God that saves you. It's the power of God that cleanses you. I quoted Revelation 1 and verse 5. He washes your sin away. When you got saved in the eyes of God, you were perfectly clean. Right now in the eyes of God, you're perfectly clean, even if you're not perfectly clean. Why is that? Because God looks through the blood of His Son, and He sees you perfectly clean. And that's why sinners can't get into heaven. God sees their sin. Yours is washed away through the blood of the Son of God. He is the only one that has the power to change you. 2 Corinthians 5:17 says, therefore, if any man be in Christ, he's a new creature. Old things are passed away. Behold, all things are become new. If you're a new creature. Now, I'm going to say this, and I don't want to give an excuse for anybody not to change. But everybody changes at different rates. When you get saved, something changes in your life. And the devil begins to fight you to keep you from changing. Boy, will he fight you too. I've told folk over the years, and one that stands out, I went by and just knocking on doors and inviting people to come and even kids to ride to the church bus and all of that. And a fellow, he said, man, I need to be saved. I really do. And I dealt with him through the scripture, and he called on the Lord. And his wife said, what about me? I said, well, you've heard everything. You can be saved. She called on the Lord, and they said, preacher, we're going to be in church tomorrow. We're going to tell everybody we got saved. And I said, listen, I've got to tell you, the devil's going to fight you. After we leave today, and I should not have said after we leave. I should have said before we leave. But I said, after we leave, the old devil's going to send somebody or something to keep you from coming to church. That's what he does. Before we got into our, well, actually we was walking. Before we walked off of his property, a car pulled in. It was some of his family members. And they began to tell him, well, you've gotten saved. Now you need to go to Grandpa's church. Grandpa's church, which had never gone by and talked to anybody's soul. They didn't care about him. They wrote him off as not going to get saved. Well, you need to go there. And we'll go with you. These other people weren't going anywhere either. And about dark, or a little later than dark, I can't tell you what year this was. Some of you may remember hearing the incident. But in La Place, Louisiana, a fuel truck was pulling over the railroad tracks. Something happened and he didn't get across, and a train came through, hit the fuel truck, and the man burned up. They got the call before midnight. It was his brother. And so they loaded up their family and went to La Place to be with the rest of the family. When they didn't show up, I didn't know. And in the middle of the week, I finally caught them at home. And they said, preacher, you're right. The devil has been on our door ever since. I said, you've got to fight it. You've got to get in church. You've got to tell people you got saved. And every time they would start to church, something would come up. And they wouldn't make it. The old devil will fight you from changing. He'll fight you from being right with God. You see, God has the power to change you. And by the way, later, that family did get things right. Got in church, got baptized, and lived for the Lord. But the old devil threw so many things to trip them up that it took them a while. As new Christians, they didn't understand that. Thirdly, God's promise to save you. You can just trust God. Don't trust me, trust God. Hebrews 7 and verse 25 says, wherefore he is able to save them to the uttermost. That's not my promise. That's God's promise. The word save means to save, to rescue, to keep you safe and sound. And that's exactly what he will do. He'll save you from your sin, but he'll also save you from a wasted life and destruction. Psalm 103 and verse 4 says, He saveth my life from destruction. When you get born again, He'll save your life from destruction. Well, there are so many today that grow up in church and their life ends up in destruction. Miss Jan and I have family members who are hooked on drugs and seemingly just can't get off. Their parents have spent all of their money, all of their retirement, sent them to rehab after rehab, remortgaged their house a number of times, and said, we've got to do all that we can to help her. And it still hadn't worked. Because they don't want to be changed, they allow Satan to drag them down to his destruction of their life. People that could have been something for God. He saves you from destruction. He promises us that nobody will be able to condemn you. In Romans 8 and 34, who is he that condemneth? It is Christ that died, yea, rather, is risen again, who is even at the right hand of God, who also maketh intercession for us. When somebody condemns you for your salvation, somebody makes fun of you for being born again, you just remember who's sitting at the right hand of the Father, saying, Father, he's mine. I've saved his soul. She was born again. They're under the blood. The accuser of the brethren is Satan. He can try to condemn you, but he can't do it because Jesus will wash your sins away. This morning, you're saved to the uttermost. This morning, have you been saved to the uttermost? Well, in 1 Peter, it tells us that we're kept by the power of God unto the day of salvation. Have you been born again? This morning, do you know the Lord as your Savior? Do you remember the time when you either got on your knees or were sitting somewhere, maybe by yourself, and you called out to God and said, Lord, forgive me for being a sinner. Wash my sins away. I give you my heart and my life. Make me your child. And he washed your sin away. Can you remember that time? I remember when it happened to me. Oh, there are times that I get a little shaky, but he doesn't. Any times I begin to wonder about those things, you know what I do? I say, no, Lord, I can't handle this. This is your business. You take care of it. And boy, the peace of God comes in. Not that I've done what's right, but that he has done what's right. Saved to the uttermost. Let's bow our heads for prayer.